Hey, what's up guys, it's Fish here and welcome back my Dwarven brothers to part 3 of my Dwarven campaign for Total War Warhammer. So, first off, apologies for calling Grimgore Ungrim last episode like a million times. I'll be trying to actively not do that throughout the rest of this Let's Play, but just know if I do apologise for it. Also, a massive thank you to everyone who went ahead and gave me names for my Runesmith and my Grudge Throwers. I got so many awesome ones and it was just a shame I couldn't use them all because they were all really, really good. But do not fret, if I do not pick your one, then I'll be having plenty more Grudge Throwers and plenty more Runesmiths, I'm sure, in my later armies. So, Ungrim Ironfist, we went ahead and named his Runesmith Ulrich Forgebreaker. I thought that was a really cool name for a Runesmith, and he's going to be an absolute monster in combat for sure. As well as that, we have Iron Rock Throwers replacing our Grudge Throwers. I thought, again, that was a cool name. So we're going to go ahead and use them to go out and be my artillery force. So I also asked you guys if you wanted me to fight this battle or not, and the majority of you guys said you did want me to fight it. I think the only people who said you didn't want me to fight it was because you wanted me to go ahead and fight Grimgore's army in the north by Karaz Karak. But don't worry, if he sticks around in the Silver Road, we will go ahead and fight him after Ungrim has a bit of time to replenish his army. So if you're looking forward to that battle, then don't worry. We will definitely fight this battle as long as he stays around. Like, if he runs back to the Badlands, I'm not going to go chasing him. But that would have happened anyway, because even if we auto-resolved this battle, we would have still had to have waited to replenish before we went after him. So, like, either way, fighting this battle is fine. You know, we will either fight Grimgore or we won't fight him, depending on if he sticks around or not. Again, this battle is going to be not as easy as it looks like as it looks, because they have a lot more men than us. They almost have 1,000 more men than us. And as well as that, they actually have a lot of Wolf Riders, which I don't really have an answer to. So yeah, I might actually just straight up close off my right flank. Like this. Yeah, just completely close it off and just kind of use my Thunderers and my Quarrelers to kind of push people back. Maybe something like this would go ahead and keep my flank protected. Yeah, let's go ahead and do that. We're going to have to use our Quarrelers as effectively as possible this battle. Go ahead and stick these guys there and spread these guys out a bit more, I think. Because they have a lot of cavalry, which we can't really deal with. Go ahead and stick the Miners over here as well to hopefully try and take out the Wolf Riders. The Longbeards, where can we put the Fishbeards? Let's go and stick them on this right flank as well, because I feel like the action will be pretty brutal around this area. And then we'll stick the Slayers on this left flank. Yeah, we'll stick the Slayers on this left flank, because if anything comes around, we can mess them up. We also have this rock on our left, kind of protecting the Oathbreakers a little bit. And hopefully the Oathbreakers can regain their honor by fighting like beasts. Oh yeah, let's also go ahead and look at Ulrich. We need to see what he looks like. Yeah, he's pretty beastly. I like that. I like that. His beard's pretty awesome. Like his helmet. But just look how big Ungrim is compared to him. Ungrim is just an absolute tank. He's huge with his mohawk. That's awesome. But yeah, the nice thing about having these Grudge Throwers is look at their range straight away. They're already shooting at the enemy straight away. We want to go ahead and focus down the Wolf Riders. Getting rid of the Wolf Riders is really, really important. I might actually split my fire though. Stick like this unit to shoot these guys maybe. Now, let's just focus down one unit, because we're getting some really nice hits off already. So let's just go ahead and focus down one unit. Again, some big hits. You know, every one of these we kill is going to be pretty good, because we just have no way to really deal with them. So we want to be focusing them down as quickly as possible. Look at our Dwarven Horde just holding the line over here. I might actually change these guys to fight on this right flank instead now. Or maybe I can just leave one to shoot over here, and this one can turn and shoot there. Yeah, that's probably a good idea. I should also move Ulrich onto this right flank as well. God, look at the enemy just approaching. Hold the line. As they're just pushing. They're going pretty heavy on this left flank. Pretty heavy indeed. I might actually have to go ahead and bring some men back, because the Slayers are just going to get overwhelmed. Oh my god, yeah. Come over, Longbeards. They have a lot of cavalry. Need the Thunderers to change. Quarrelers focus them down. You guys focus down their archers. Yeah, we just need to get our quarries to start shooting down here as well. Luckily, the slayers can actually deflect arrows off of their weapons. So they're going to get hit pretty hard, though. We need to be careful. We need the longbeards over here to help out. And the quarrelers just to wreck them. Yeah, we need to get ready to start charging in the center now. Charge forward. But they're pushing hard on this left flank. Like, really, really hard. Luckily, the longbeards are going to be here ready to receive the enemy charge. Oh my god, they just got smashed. I'm sorry, longbeards. A lot of them are getting back up, though, which is good. They're heavily armored, so they can kind of deal with this. Slayers can go in as well. Yeah, there's two wolf riders on this right flank. Oh my god, yeah, they've got like, they haven't gone hard whatsoever on this right flank, so we can kind of abuse that. Reinforce over here. Ulrich can charge in. Quarrelers can need to keep shooting, though, at these archers. But as soon as we deal with the archers, it's going to be GG. Let's slow things down just for now. As we charge forward, just give make sure everyone has decent commands. Make sure this bad boy's shooting. Make sure my archers are all shooting at the right targets. And then we can actually watch some of the battle actually unfold. I'm going to move these guys around this right flank. Charge them in there. It's because they just have so many fast units. It's just, you know, a very, very fast-paced. Come on, Ungrim. Force your way to the front. Ulrich is charging in as well. Yeah, look at him. He's with the men. Who's he with? He's with the siege breakers on this right flank. Force your way to the front. Charge forward. Keep making sure the cannons are shooting. Quarrelers are just putting up a lot of hurt. I might actually change focus on these quarrelers to focus down these chariots. Again, these archers could be kind of annoying to deal with. Let's go ahead and just leave one to shoot the archers and one to shoot them. That seems like a good plan. The slayers involved against some goblin spears. They should be slaughtering them. The longbeards and the slayers. These goblins are just no match at all. Oh, look at them just jumping as well. That is awesome. Yeah, they should be more than enough to deal with them. Again, we just have to be a bit careful of them goblin riders. Which we will be shooting with these guys. I might just change everyone round just to kind of focus them down. Yeah, as I said, we just don't really have a way to deal with them, and it's really, really frustrating. They can just hammer and anvil wherever they want. Like, by the looks of it, that's what they're going to be doing, charging into my grudge throwers. I'm more than happy just to take this melee engagement with them. There's not many of them left, and we can probably force them away, if I'm honest. Nice, routing them over here. Let's continue our pressure. Where is Ungrim as well? Yeah, that's what I was looking for. Is Ungrim just like smashing fools away? There he is, yeah. How you doing, Ungrim? He's surrounded. But I'm sure that he's able to just wreck anyone. Come on, let's go ahead and slaughter some people. Here we go. That's what we like to see. That's what we like to see indeed. Oh, that one orc just got wrecked. So let's go ahead and zoom out and go ahead and just kind of reevaluate the situation. Nice, their general is actually jumping into combat over here as well. So we definitely want to be at least somewhat looking at him to kind of focus him down. On this left flank, we're doing more than okay. We don't have any like poppable abilities yet. This right flank is actually causing me a bit of issue right now. They're definitely putting in some work. We need to make sure we try and kill their general as well. Yeah, his right flank is struggling pretty heavily, but the center has been completely won now. So I'm going to go ahead and throw these guys around. We just need to kill their general, and the battle is probably ours. And they're starting to waver on this left flank. Yeah, we smashed them there. Nice. You guys all come round. Chase down their general, and victory should be ours. Let's go ahead and just throw in our quarrelers as well into melee. Because these guys are all really, really good as well. The Iron Brigade taking shots off at the enemy. Anyone who comes back is just going to get shot to pieces. Yeah, oh, by the looks of it, one of the Siegebreaker units might actually rout, but that's not to be, you know, that's fine. They definitely fought bravely this battle. Ungrim again is just slaughtering everyone. Absolute beast. I mean, all his traits as well, all the equipment he's kind of gathered in this battle is still just so good as well. Like, he's got one of, I think it is his weapon, gives him plus 6 melee attack and defense, which is really, really huge. And his armor gives him, like, an 8% ward save as well, which reduces all armor, all damage coming. So it just makes him into an absolute tank. Hopefully we can make Ulrich into an absolute tank as well. Because the Runesmith abilities are so good. Again, they get abilities which negate damage. Oh my god, these Wolf Riders. Just keep pushing, boys. We've almost dealt with them. Their general has, like, no health left. They're just going to be charging in on him now. Yeah, there's no way he is getting out of here. He will rue the day that he messed with me. And there we go. Victory is ours. Did we kill him, or is he trying to get out? How much health is he on? Yeah, I can't bother to chase him down. Oh, yeah, it's a siege battle as well. We don't have to. Nice. Let's go and save the battle just in case I need it for a thumbnail. But I'm sure we'll fight another battle this episode. So we only lost 400 men or 500 men. I'm happy with that. 500 losses. Oh, look how many kills UNGRIM got. 122. That's not bad for Ulrich either. Ulrich got 50, almost 60 for his maiden battle. That's pretty good. Coral is doing good. Thunder is 100 kills. The Fishbeard's 110. The Oathbreaker's only got 79. I feel like they need to get a lot more kills than that before I finally let them back into my army and don't make them be dishonored by having that name. My Quarry is actually getting experience as well. That's good to see. Two chevrons. Nice, nice. And yeah, everyone else is doing pretty good. The Siege Breakers, I think, are on this right flank. Again, racking up a decent amount of kills. They're under a lot of fire as well, so I'm proud of them that they held their own. And I don't think that unit actually routed as well. The unit which was kind of wavering. But yeah, the Slayer's just absolutely going in. Decisive victory. How much loot are we gaining? 500 gold. We definitely need that money. Oh, we got a talisman. Talisman of prevention. What does that do? 20% ward save. Right, that's insane. Yeah, like, ward save. Any type of damage is reduced by this amount. So, in total, UNGRIM is taking 28% less damage. Just every bit of damage. This is without taking into account his armor or his melee defense. So he's already not receiving 28% less damage. Damn, that is insane. 20%. That's really, really good. So we managed to defeat Spite Backbiter, killing every single orc, not letting a single one survive. We should hopefully also fulfill a grudge as well. My vows will be so Legendary Lord, yeah, nice. Level 7, I think he upgraded. We went ahead and completed a grudge as well, giving us 700 gold. I'm happy with that for sure. Restless. So I was actually looking at this before the episode, and I think what I'm going to do is, I know I want to make him into a beast fighter. However, the Foe Seeker ability and the Deadly Onslaughter ability, they're good, but they're not as good as the morale buff ones down below. Because these are just like self-augments to himself to make him into like a really good fighter. And granted, these like Blade Master and stuff like that are really good. However, I'd much rather get to Stand Your Ground, which gives you plus 16 leadership in the aura, gives all the units in the aura 36 melee defense and 34 melee attack. Like, that's huge for, like, what, 11 seconds? Yeah, so it pretty much just makes your army really sick for, like, a short period of time. And the cooldown isn't even that big either, I don't think. Yeah, it's only a minute and a half cooldown, so you'll be able to pop that, like, 3 or 4 times in a battle. So we're going to go ahead and start focusing down that tree. Also, the Inspiring Presence is pretty good because it gives plus 5% leadership in the aura of the general just automatically. So if we look at our leadership for our units, like, it's already insane. Like, they've already on 76, 70, and that's without them being in battle and them being in the aura. So they're going to be getting a lot more leadership from that as well. For the wisdom of the land. So I also went ahead and renamed Kazrick the Lord of Terror. You guys reminded me of what his name was. So we'll go ahead and put him back in Karazkarak and build him some men. This is going to be kind of painful for our economy. But I mean, it'll be okay in the long run for sure. We'll go ahead and build this gem mine as well, because we need the money ASAP. Yeah, we really, really need the money. I might just go ahead and get two. Yeah, get two warriors there. Because I mean, UNGRIM will be able to help if he does decide to besiege. Okay, cool. So let's go ahead and end the turn. After we've done our edict, I think again we just go for Master of Steel and Stone, because that gives 10% construction decrease of cost for all buildings. So whenever we build stuff, it'll be 10% cheaper, which kind of makes me want to wait next turn to do this, because it'll save me a bit of money, right? It'll save me 200 gold, so I think I'm just going to wait till this edict's in in fruition and then do it then. The other ones give me growth and additional tradable resource. The hiking tribute gives me plus 5% tax, and this one gives me public order and minus corruption, which will be really important later on. You'll probably notice me when the storms of chaos happen, I'm going to be kind of switching all my edicts to minus corruption, because corruption plays a real big part towards the late game. So by the looks of it, Grimgore is going to run away with his tail between his legs, and I guess we're just going to let him, because I'm not really going to chase him down with Khazrik's army. Ungrim still needs plenty of time to replenish. So yeah, we're just going to kind of chill out for the next couple turns, I guess. We have a lot of money, which is good, which we will spend now. So yeah, we saved 200 gold. Well, that's actually really, really good. So yeah, let's go ahead and run through the buildings quickly, because something I noticed in my last two episodes is I'm kind of just clicking buildings and like, oh yeah, I'm going to get this building, and just kind of expecting you guys to know what it is. So I'm quickly, just like a quick couple minutes, just going to run through all my buildings and kind of the chains and stuff. So hopefully you guys get a better idea of what I'm building and why I'm building it by just looking at the picture. So yeah, first off, so you can see we've got like a level system on this left hand side of all these fortresses, and basically what this means is the level of your city allows you to build a level of a building. So if I wanted to go ahead and upgrade my siege workshop to my gunsmith forge, I could only do that in a town which had a tier 3 city. So if I had a tier 2 city and a siege workshop, I wouldn't be able to upgrade it because I needed that next tier. So yeah, I really like the building mechanic as well. I think it's pretty cool. So we'll quickly just run through everything and what I get the units from. So from my siege workshop, I get my grudge throwers. The next upgrade gives me thunderers and cannons. Then the next upgrade from that at a tier 4 city will give me iron drakes, organ guns, and my first gyrocopter. And then finally, my next upgrade from that at tier 5 city, which is pretty crazy, will give me a flame cannon, a gyro bomber, and the gyrocopter with a brimstone gun, which will be cool. I can't wait to get them. They're going to be pretty fun to use. Also, if I wanted to get hammerers and iron breakers, I'll need a tier 4 city. I'll need to obviously get the Hall of Oaths. And then I'll also need to go ahead and get this armory to go ahead and allow me to build them. But we'll get onto that in a second. Engineering workshop. This allows me to actually build my organ guns and iron drakes. So to kind of get these units, I'll need to build this foundry, have a tier 4 city, and get an engineer workshop. And then to upgrade it, then it allows me to get these guys as well. Slayers, I can get a tier 3 city, but they cost me so much money. They cost me 9k, and that's with my edict as well. So if I didn't have an edict, which reduces building cost by 10%, it would be 10,000 gold. That's crazy, just to get Slayers. But again, Slayers are beast, and we want to try and get that kind of quickly. They also go ahead and reduce vampiric corruption, which is really, really important, as I said, for the late game. So I might actually build this in my capital. Then for tier 3 to get the armory, this allows me to get longbeards and slayers and dwarfs with great weapons, as long as I have my muster hall, which is my military building, which gives me my longbeards, my quarrelers, and a fane, and the longbeards, yeah. So I need to upgrade that. Then the tier 2 one gives me iron breakers and hammerers, granted I have the Hall of Oaths. And then the last one just gives me a massive boost to all my ranks and stuff. Gem shaft, like this slot is normally just for the tradable resource. So if we go to the Pillar of Grugnir, you can see they don't actually have a gem shaft or anything like that. They just get given a tinker maker, which is kind of just like a basic gold giver. But if the province has a resource, it'll kind of replace this with, for example, a gem mine shaft or a logging camp or a fur trader, something along those lines. A unique building that the dwarves get is the Throne Hall of the High King. And just look at the buffs. 10 public order in this province, 5% tax boost, better ranks for my recruited generals, more experience for hammerers, and a plus 2 public order buff for everyone in my empire, which is amazing. Absolutely amazing. So the economic buildings, I have a guild marketplace or a trade depot. This building goes ahead and boosts my tradable resources and tariffs from my trade, as well as gives me more income from all buildings. The barley fields go ahead and give you more growth and replenishment. And then finally, the like pubs or the drinking halls go ahead and give you more public order. So yeah, hopefully now you guys have a better understanding of how the buildings work. If you already knew that, then apologies, kind of like for drawing this episode out a little bit. But you know, hopefully for those of you who haven't played the game yet, because obviously the game is not even out yet, you guys have a better understanding. So what do we want here? Oh yeah, also we get the watch room. These are kind of like garrison posts. And if you get the tier 3 one, or the tier 2 one, but in the tier 3 city, you can actually go ahead and get walls in the city. So it's actually pretty easy to go ahead and get a walled city now, which is cool. I like the kind of change they've done with that. Very much so. And also it gives you such a hefty garrison. Again, this is one of the things in Warhammer. They just go ahead and give you really beastly garrisons, which is awesome. So I'm going to go and end the turn again. I just need Ungrim to keep on boosting up his men's HP. And then we'll probably move back down, if you can see in the bottom right-hand side, Karag Dron. We also have to pay attention to that army as well, which has just popped up from the Bloody Spears. We definitely have to keep an eye on them. So a Dwarven caravan is being raided. We can either help them smash the enemy back. Gives me plus 5 leadership and minus public order. Or we can go ahead and just let them be on their own. Take the leadership debuff, minus five leadership debuff, and then take the public order. I'm going to take the public order because we do really, really need it. And as well as that, like, the leadership is not really too much of an issue for me. Like, I already have a huge leadership buff anyway. So that's not really too much of an issue. I'm going to go ahead and get... what do we want? I really want Call to Clans, but I feel like I'm not going to be building warriors anytime soon. So I might, and if I do, I'll probably be doing it in the next 4 turns. So let's go ahead and just get this. It only takes 3 turns and it gives us plus 5% income from settlements, which is pretty big. And we need it because we're kind of broke at the moment. So let's just end the turn again. See what the army to the south does. It'll be interesting to see if they move forward. No, they're just going to go away, which is fine. We're going to go ahead and assume raid Varric Hills there. A warg army down there to the south. So I guess Ungrim can go ahead and start making his move. His men are fully replenished. I don't think we can... Oh, we can actually get here. That's very interesting. Okay, cool. What I'm going to do for protection is that I'm going to move Khazric over to this province. And this is why. Because if that goblin army comes up, it will probably ignore Karaz Karak because it already has an absolute insane garrison. Look at that. Hammerers, longbeards, etc. Like, they're never going to take this even with a full stack. Whereas a Pillar of Grugni doesn't really have any good troops here. So if I have Khazric here, it should make it a lot more defendable. For sure. Like, it'll make it a lot harder for them to take it. And I might even just recruit another unit or two. Next turn when we're not in Tunneling Stance. So yeah, I feel like that way I'll be a lot more well protected if that Goblin army does decide to come up here. Which it might not. It might just stay down in Barak Var. Oh my god, Barak Var are going in. They normally never defeat the orcs, like ever, whenever I play as the dwarves. So that is really, really good that they're going in. They've lost this, well, they haven't taken this province, but they've still got 3, so hats off to them. A confederation between the Scabby Eyes and the Greenskins. Again, that's just kind of what happens, is the Greenskins just get really, really big. You can see they've taken like a bunch more territory because they've joined up with the Scabby Eyes. Barak Var doing really good. Do they want to form a...
I don't want to talk to you, stupid.
Oh no, I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to talk to you either. Let's go ahead and talk to Barak Var.
What can the Dawi do for you on this?
Let's get a defensive alliance. That'll go and also give us map vision. And eventually we'll hopefully get a confederation, which means we just get their land, basically. It gives like a debuff to public order and stuff. But you just like absorb them into your kingdom, which is a cool feature. Oh, Ulrich leveled up, which is good. Let's go ahead and get him down the road of runes. Runes of Hearth and Home. Because, you know, the first one, so as soon as he hits level 3, we'll get the Rune of Oath and Steel. This gives plus 15 armor to everyone in the surrounding area. That's really, really good. And then later on down the line, you get damage spells. You get plus armor piercing to everyone around you. Melee attack. Weapon strength, you know, melee damage. And then this one at the right at the end, 44% damage resistance to everyone around you in a 50 meter aura, which is insane. So we definitely want to get him down there. And I guess we just move on this province, so we don't have to worry too much. We'll just straight up win it. Decisive victory. I mean, I don't see Ungrim dying anytime soon in battle. He is so good. And he also leveled up again. I'm just going to straight up sack it, I think.
Beards in belts.
We got a Warrior Bane. We can actually give back to our Runesmith. Oh, no. We don't want to give back to our Runes. Oh, is it a Hex? So it gives -6% weapon damage to everyone around them. Does that include allies? Because it doesn't really say. It's constant. Instantly affects target in area. Around self affects enemy. Enemies in range. Oh, cool. So it just reduces their... Okay, that makes sense. UNGRIM leveled up as well. So I might actually go ahead and give that to our slayer. Oh, bonus versus large, that's good. But yeah, again, I feel like we just keep on going down this tree because stand your ground is just such a good ability. So let's go ahead and get Axe Lord. This gives us +3 melee defense to all dwarven warriors in our army. We also have Tactician, which gives more ammunition. That reduces the amount our men get tired, and that goes ahead and gives us bonuses to morale in underground battles. So I think Axe Lord is just a lot better. And then we'll go ahead and just take the city after sacking it for all the money.
This may work.
And we already get a muster hall here, which is good, or a spring chamber, sparring chamber. So I'll take that for sure. For the wisdom, yeah, Barak Vahar are doing really good. But I mean, that really helps me out because it protects my my western borders for sure. And we can kind of focus on going down the mountains. And then we can just absorb them when we want to. I feel like we have to upgrade this to a clan barracks so we get quarrelers. But again, we could just upgrade this to... This gives us more money, more public order, more growth. A lot more money. And also improves the garrison hugely. Now, let's just go ahead and upgrade it to a dwarven keep from an outpost. It's like pretty much all of our money, but it's worth it, I think. Hopefully also go ahead and make them happy again. Let's go ahead and end the turn again. I guess we'll move down to Iron Rock if no one else does. If Barak Vahar, by the looks of it, they are moving down. Okay, that's fair enough. They're more than welcome to take that. Because again, remember, like, eventually
grows, my lord. News of your conquest spreads far and wide. Your developing power is noted by even the most distant of kings and bestial lords.
Good, that's what we like to hear. So, oh my god, we just got a bunch of money as well. Occupy, loot, or raise 3 different settlements. We got 2 grand for the reward and 2 grand for meeting the bonus objective. Which I'm not actually sure what it is, what the bonus objective is, but apparently we got 2 grand for it, so I'm more than happy. The Slayer's Crown. So dark clouds have enveloped in Sylvania, so we need to go ahead and move a Fane up here. So basically, what these kind of quest issues are, these are like quest chains, which I think are really, really interesting. We also, for the Ancestry, need to loot or raise 5 more cities, and we get 4 grand. I'm happy with that. So yeah, basically what these are like quests for the items. So instead of just like having the quest battle on the screen straight away, you actually have to do some stuff. So if I want to go ahead and get the Slayer's Crown, I have to go ahead and move a Fane up to the north and do some other stuff. And then the quest battle will appear and then we'll go and do that. And I really like that kind of chain because it's not like a simple go here, do fight this battle and you get the item. There's actually some objectives to meet outside of that, which I really, really like. And this item is insane. 8 armor, 3 melee defense, 3 melee attack. Experience upgrade for all slayers recruited in this army. Public order buff. Chance of intercepting in the underway. And a reduction, a huge reduction to chaos corruption, which will be really, really important later on in the game. So that's a really good item. We definitely want to try and focus that down as soon as possible. I think I'm going to go ahead and get called to clan now. Just because it's nice to have. And I guess eventually, in like maybe 10 turns time, we'll start building up Kazakh's army. So we want to go ahead and try our best to upgrade this next. Yeah, we want to go ahead and get to a minor hall as soon as we can with the next of our growth points. So in 7 turns, we'll upgrade this, and then we'll upgrade this so we can get a Fane. And then we'll send the Fane up to Zifbar, is it? If we look to our quests, which is this button, Slayer's Crown. Yeah, so Zifbar's right here. We need to send the Fane there. So we will be doing that as soon as we can. And yeah, but it looks like Barak Vahar just going on a mad one. Assaulting the Iron Rock. I mean, obviously Black Crag. Black Crag has a beastly garrison. 3 units of Black Orcs and Orc Biggins. That's going to be something scary. But for now, like, what do we do with his army now? I mean, it's only happy, right, because of his military... Yeah, 20 for military presence. That's pretty crazy. I guess we just end the turn for now. Yeah, they actually managed to conquer Iron Rock, so shout out to them. Barak Vahar are doing a good job this playthrough. Grudge issued. The Bugman Grudge. So this is talking about how Joseph Bugman's brewery got destroyed, right? And only a few cases succeed. Yeah, so we have to go ahead and defeat just any orc tribes, three of them, which we can definitely do. I guess we want to just march on with Black Crag, right? And is our army good enough? They have three black orcs. Like, that's pretty impressive. And two units of trolls. And they're defending a city. I guess we make our way there? After we get a bit more happiness here. Yeah, I guess we'll start marching on the Black Crag. Unless something else presents itself, I guess that's what we do. Yeah, we'll go ahead and upgrade this now to a tier 2. We have the money to do it, so that's fine. This is almost done, so we actually need to save some money for this as well so we can build our next building. Because I think we'll be able to get an armory. Yeah, so we'll actually be able to start getting longbeards already when that's built. We need to obviously complete this grudge. And then that's four done, so we're halfway to getting four grim, because we need to complete eight grudges, if you guys remember. Doug, go ahead and get four grim as a legendary commander. Which will obviously be beastly. He can obviously accompany Kazarik and Ungrim. So yeah, I guess we just start making our way downtown, you know, walking fast. Faces past, and we'll be homebound. So obviously this is going to go ahead and start reducing the happiness of this city pretty hugely. But once we go ahead and take the Black Crag after like two or three turns of assaulting it, I'm sure, yeah, this won't get 100 before, this won't get a rebellion before we take the Black Crag, I'm sure. But I honestly don't know if we're even going to be strong enough to take the Black Crag. Because they have three Black Orc units, like that's pretty good. Granted, we have some Slayers to deal with Trolls. And the Boar Riders, and we also have our Grudge Throwers to start smashing away at their encampment. But still, you know, that's going to be a pretty important battle. Also, the morale over here is not good. We're definitely going to need to upgrade this. Yeah, we'll probably build a brewery over here when we can. When this upgrades to tier 3, I think. Yeah, because this is done next turn. Cool, let's end the turn again as we march down south to the Black Crag. We'll also keep an eye on making a coalition with Barakvar. Because if we can make a coalition with them at any point, that'll be good. Because we absorb all their lands. And we'll need to kind of complete this building as well. So we can actually besiege it this turn if we march. Yeah, you can look at the odds. They're just not in our favor. We'll go and starve them out for a little bit. Build some siege towers and stuff. But yeah, things are not looking good. I think I can still win this. Because I can use my quarrelers to shoot these guys to pieces and my catapults. So I'm not too scared. We're going to just continue the siege. But if they bring up any reinforcements, we're going to have to run away. Like if they bring up an army from down here. Oh, there's Carrick Apeaks down here as well. So we actually met another Dwarven faction. We can probably trade. No, we can't trade with them. Yeah, Carrick Azul down here to the south. How you doing, bro?
Greetings, kin of
non-aggression. No, you don't want a non-aggression. That's fine.
Aye, let's hear what you have to say.
Anyone else want to trade with us? No, still no trading. So I'm probably not going to fight this battle this episode. Unfortunately, I think we're only going to get one battle this episode, which kind of sucks. So yeah, as I said, like you normally only want to go ahead and get the buildings which go to tier 5 in your capital. You don't want any of these buildings which don't go to tier 5 in your capital. Like eventually, I'm probably going to end up getting rid of this mineshaft to get something else. Just because I need this tier 5 slot to get better buildings. That's why I haven't got my muster field here, because it goes up to tier 3 and I can get that elsewhere. I mean, same with the armory as well. If I want to, I can just get an armory here. Obviously, I can't get the next upgrade, so I wouldn't be able to get iron breakers or hammers here. So I guess we do get the armory here, right? Is the smartest move, and we'll continue our siege. So siege timers in this are actually really, really long. You can see if we hover over this, time remaining before surrendering is 13. Also, if we look at the, so they also have 8 turns before they run out of supplies and start starving. So there's actually a huge timer on this game before like of sieges, which I feel like they should probably try and tone down a bit, in my personal opinion. Because I just feel like siege timers are kind of just a bit too long. Because you don't really want to be sticking around for 13 turns to starve it out. But again, it makes sense. You know, a huge fortress, it'd be able to survive for at least some time. You know, sieges would have gone for a long time. Oh, hero recruited. Rise of the Fanes. So we actually got a fane for free. Awesome. So, in this episode, I need a name for my Thane. What should I call him? And we can also move him to Zufbar straight away as soon as I can. I'm going to be doing that. To go ahead and complete Ungrim's first part of his quest to get his crown. Again, Kazrick leveled up. We'll go ahead and give him the scar. Oh no, crap. I want to give him the movement range, actually. So important. So yeah, we've got, actually got a Thane now. That's awesome. Brock Iron Pick for now, but hopefully we'll change that. He's pretty cool as well. Yeah, so we'll move him to Zifbar as soon as we can. Ulrich also leveled up. We'll go ahead and get the Rune of Oath and Steel. That's going to be really important for the coming battle. I mean, hopefully the dwarf tribes to the south of us will go ahead and hold back the Orc advance. That'd be really good for us. So we can just continue our siege of Barakvar, continue to get siege towers. You know, still another two more turns until we have these siege towers. I'm actually going to get some more if I can as well. Three turns, that's fine. So cool, I'm going to go ahead and end the episode here because I kind of want to leave this Black Crag battle for next episode because I think it would be really, really awesome. We're going to get the missile damage as well for our quarrelers. So yeah, I kind of want to leave that siege battle for next episode, something for you guys to look forward to. Everything else is building. We'll be upgrading this in two turns' time. They'll hopefully go ahead and sort out the happiness issue. We've got our Thane, who will soon be named, to move over here. Can we move him yet or not? No, I need to end the turn. So let's go end the turn. And yeah. Oh, so Grimgor has moved up here. That's fine. Barakvar should be more than capable enough to deal with him. Chaos stirs. Oh no. So the chaos clouds gather in the north. There are rumors that barbarian tribes are residing in the shadows of chaos. Master your strength. So the chaos is starting to kind of just start peeking on the map, you know. There's rumors in the north. But I'm actually astonished. This campaign is going really well for the dwarfs. I've never seen the dwarfs do this well. I've never seen the dwarfs take all of this and take all of this before. Like, normally the orcs just wreck them, but this episode they haven't whatsoever. Or this let's play, the dwarfs are doing really well. I mean, I'm not complaining whatsoever. So we'll continue to get some more of our siege equipment over here. Is attacked. So two more turns before we assault this. So yeah, I hope you guys are enjoying this let's play. A massive thank you to everyone who's dropping likes and comments on each episode. I really, really appreciate it. So yeah, for this episode, let me know what I should call this Thane. And also go ahead and, yeah, actually, don't worry about giving me infantry names. I'll look back on ones you guys have already suggested. And yeah, so massive thank you to all the support. And I'll see you guys next time. And fish out.